welcome everybody to the Thursday, August 31st, Spokane City Council study session. We're in our briefing area that we used to use back in the old days, and it's friendlier than the council chambers, so thank you. So, welcome, and we have our first guest today, Jan Takamoto, and she's going to talk about substance abuse, behavioral health treatment options, and availability. So welcome, Jan.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
I think we're going to need to use the mic.
Yeah. Good morning. I'm here with Justin Johnson, who is with the VH ASO, and he's going to talk about the services that are available. Before I begin, I wanted to let all of you know that we lost our CEO, Jeff Lamas, last Friday. And there's going to be a celebration of life for him on Tuesday the 5th from 3 to 5 at the Grove School of Climate.
Hold on just a second. Jacoby?
That microphone is on. I'll just really need to speak.
Okay. I just wanted to share that with you because I know that all of you had some type of contact with Jeff, and as you know, he was a real champion for behavioral health services in Eastern Washington, and especially in Eastern Washington. So I'm going to have Justin introduce himself to you and talk with you about the substance use and behavioral health services that we have here in Spokane, and then I'll talk specifically about Frontier Behavioral Health and some of the specialty programs that we have that have frequent contact with individuals who have substance use disorders or behavioral health concerns.
Good morning, Council. Justin Johnson, I'm the director of Spokane County's Community Services Department, which manages and oversees the Spokane County Regional VH ASL, Administrative Services Organization, receives a contract from the Healthcare Authority to provide for non-Medicaid services throughout Spokane County and the Six County region, area Lincoln, Stevens, Andre, and Adams County. It also provides for crisis system services, including the regional crisis line, and for involuntary treatment services. So for anyone who is detained with one of our DCRs in the community, we oversee both that crisis system through our sub-delegated responsibilities with FDH for Spokane County, and we also pay for those involuntary treatment services. So it's just a brief kind of overview of what we look at. And then we also have and run various other programs. And Jen asked me to come just share a little bit about the overview because we're pretty plugged into the entire community in terms of engagement and connection. Really, we are the gap filler for anyone who's not covered by insurance, for those that are covered by commercial insurance that are unable to pay for those, or meet a certain level of financial threshold where their ability to pay has been severely limited. And again, the state really limits that gap area. So commercial coverage, depending on what you have and what you maybe have access to in your plan, may open some doors, and then ours may open other doors. In just a quick review of the system of care, I think it's important to just identify how many providers do we have, right, in our region. Again, those are going to be subject to specific rules, right? What does Medicaid pay for? What does commercial pay for? And then ultimately, what is private pay? And various centers have certain licensing rules, Department of Health, that each of those entities bill or have certain contracts or agreements, which then limit access. So I want to preface this by saying, even though we may discuss or provide specifics on bed or service availability, it may not actually be available because that's determined upon what insurance you have. I think that's a key point to recognize. When people throw bed numbers around, when we talk about inpatient, there's 100 beds. Is there really 100 beds? Or maybe you only have access to 5 of those beds because your insurance won't cover that. Or your ability to pay is limited. And so that's why we say 100 beds really isn't 100 beds. That's really narrowing down. In addition, federal dollars that pay for a lot of these services require that individuals be residents of the area and have a residency status in the United States. If you are unrepresented and you do not have a permanent status in the U.S. or you're considered an illegal alien, terminology used by the federal government, then certain federal funds are not available, and so there is very limited funding available for substance use services in the community. And so I'm going to preface that. So when you hear me talk about anything, all of those have those rules that apply down before it occurs. And for the ASO, we look at residency within Spokane County and the regional service area. So if you were to be coming from King County and you were here on vacation, enjoying the wonderful area of Spokane County, and then you were to receive a service, you might have insurance that doesn't or doesn't have a contract with an entity here, and thus may not have access to those beds. In addition, before I jump into covering those services, there's also the challenge that with the reduced services here, depending on the level of care, a lot of those are located outside of our regions. Spokane County residents are transferred out of region, and I'll kind of talk about why that occurs. And simply, it's about what is the level of care in need, and do we have that resource available in our community? So, pause there if there's any questions, and then kind of go overview on services.
Any questions, Council?
Thank you. We met. I've heard this before. I guess I just get frustrated with the community because they just say, "Well, this is human treatment." You know, just like that is a magic bullet, and that is going to happen immediately. So can we really talk about the number of beds, but really who qualifies for those beds, and the struggle that some providers go through to get people into those beds, and who pays, it really narrows that number down. So as you present, I'm really looking at capacity in our community, and if so, how could we help grow that capacity?
Yeah, and I think it's important to identify where is the capacity needed, right? Is it acute care level beds that are inpatient? Is it outpatient? Partial hospitalization? Depth of outpatient? Those are different levels. And really, those unlock key areas by which we look at preventative and diversion services, which say, will it move forward? So do we need those beds? Do we have other resources? And then we also have the challenge of the most recent Judge Peckman order, the contempt hearing against East Houston Hospital, where now we're having an influx of individuals being discharged and being unable to access that resource, further straining the system, including our crisis system. So again, there's a lot of challenges to this, and then I'm gonna come back with some good news about how our system in Spokane County specifically really is robust in a lot of ways, but we're still facing a lot of challenges. It's not all bad news, but it does add a unique and complex look at when an individual or a provider says, "Hey, I wanna access a bed." The hurdles they have to jump through are not.
Thank you. So if I'm homeless, having a crisis on the streets, and I need emergency medical mental health assistance, and they take me to the county city stabilization?
The regional stabilization center?
Regional stabilization center. Can I get a, do they have to first find out who's gonna pay for it before I get a bed, or?
I would say first and foremost, it's not as simple as saying you immediately go there. They'll do medical clearance before going there, so you may go to the hospital, get medically cleared, then they decide whether or not you can meet medical necessity criteria to be admitted. For Medicaid-covered entities, for the four major Medicaid carriers in our region, they have contracts. So they would meet that, but again, they have to submit medical necessity criteria to them, get approval, just like you would for any insurance, and then they would enter. Now, most of them are almost accepted right away, as long as the need is addressed by law enforcement or hospital. But they can't walk in off the street. Law enforcement has to be involved and generate medical clearance. Then when they finally met that need, right, then it's either stabilization, it's withdrawal management, or it's co-occurring. If you don't hit those key areas, medical necessity, then that service wouldn't be available to you. So after going through that, then you would be able to access it, which is why, again, it's a wonderful place. It was absolutely necessary in the region. It isn't the fix for everything that we see on the street.
And those beds there aren't always full. I mean, we're not at capacity a lot because of those different criteria for coverage and who's paying for what, right?
Well, they're not always at 100%, but they're definitely running at a last check, 70 or higher percent capacity.
Okay.
Yeah. So, again, really looking at how many people are there and how long do they remain, right? How long is that medical necessity criteria, meaning the symptomology is continuing? And then the second part to that is, how long can their insurance approve them? Because they have to after a certain amount of days get reapproval, just like any of us do with our commercial insurance. The challenge has been commercial insurance. They don't all cover it. So let's say somebody happened to have a child that was on the street who was potentially utilizing these substances, and they have involved in law enforcement. Law enforcement said, yeah, they need to go there. They go there. They're covered by their parents' commercial insurance. They get there, and they say, no, we're not going to cover that. Or the deductible is $1,000. At that point, you know, what do you do? And that's where the ASO generally steps in and says, hey, we can pay for this, but you have to meet a threshold. That's the federal standards for that. And the state standards is 220% at or below the federal poverty level. A lot of people are right in between that.
Right.
Yeah. And we find that a lot of people with commercial insurance. Commercial insurance is a big challenge to build. So I think that's one of the gap areas you see in the community. Now, there's a lot of other resources that they have. When we look at the ones that the county and the city partner together with providers, that's where we see some challenges.
Justin, again, I appreciate having worked with you both in the past. Can you talk about, when it comes to bed availability, is staffing still an issue for making some beds available? What does our staffing of these services look like?
Yes, I was actually going to touch on that when we covered some of these, because I wanted to give some numbers and then give some caveats to that. And then, of course, Jen will speak to the service availability in her area. Workforce continues to be a challenge. And I think we think about this, oh, it's an issue now. It was an issue 5 years ago, and we're now just seeing the repercussions of that. So individuals who are going into this profession said, oh, I'm not going to make any money. I'm going to go somewhere else. Better become an accountant than a master's of, I mean, when I started out in this field with a master's degree doing on-the-ground crisis work, $44,000, right? I mean, telling someone, hey, you're going to make a profession out of that when you're making less than other professions that will require a bachelor's degree, it's just insane. And now we move forward, we finally started saying, hey, it's probably that flow from the colleges still takes 5 years for them to be trained and brought forward. So we're going to see this actually come forward to fruition. Right now, yeah, we're being challenged. And here's the other part. Everyone, when we start new programs, we open new facilities, or we expand services like crisis, where do you think those individuals come from? Come from another program. So we see this ebb and flow where some programs are doing great, and then all of a sudden people leave, and then it's chaos. We have a provider up north that someone opened a new facility, and then we expanded another service, and they're at a 40% vacancy in their outpatient service. So then they can't take individuals into their program. So when we talk about availability, they have plenty of availability when they're full. But then when they're 40% vacant, then they can't take new admits. Then you're seeing a month-long wait list for those. We're seeing that in Spokane County as well. Yeah. So I'll go quickly over the numbers of the different facilities. Now, all of these facilities that are licensed under the Department of Health providing SGD services are listed under their directory. It is a state requirement that that's listed. Go to Department of Health, they have a BHA directory, and you can get a list. There's across the entire state. I pulled out Spokane County. Now, remember, not all take all insurances, so that's the caveat here. So,
before you go on, Could you define what you mean by commercial insurance?
Yeah, commercial is what we call the employer-paid insurances, those plans like AmeriBlue Cross, okay. Kaiser Permanente. Those are the ones in the commercial sector that aren't paid out by the state and or some other employee paid plans.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
So secure withdrawal management services, formerly known as detox services, those are inpatient facilities that reach a certain ASAM level of care. And those services are generally individuals who are withdrawing and are severely withdrawn and need ongoing treatment and care. There's limited facilities in Washington State. In fact, as you guys know, COSA, DBHS, closed their secure swims facility here because of workforce challenges. And so we have a limited number within our area. At the last count, there was 5 available ones that we have access to in our region, either here or over to Wenatchee. The closest secure withdrawal management facility is Parkside in Wenatchee. It's COSA closed. Now, there are other facilities that provide withdrawal management in our area. STARS is one of those. Sequoia provides it as well for commercial insurance. But secure, ones that are detained against their will and are 71 alive, the closest one, Parkside. The other one is in Chehalis. So we're sending our members across the state, and then they're coming back. And we're having issues with transportation. youth swims. This is really sad. We don't have any currently listed Department of Health. There's ongoing work that we're working with Department of Health and other providers in our community, but there is no youth facilities. And that includes for some of the ENT or stabilization level of care. That's a gap there. So when a youth is experiencing it, anyone from 13 to 17 and 364 days, we don't have those resources available. Outpatient, we have 36 outpatient providers, all trying to compete in your workforce. That's a challenge. And the current list of wait lists for individuals, primarily on the Medicaid side, is 2 weeks to get into intake and assessment and then get assigned a clinician, even with 36 outpatient providers. Inpatient, that's anything for recovery house, that's intensive inpatient services on the ASAM level of care. I don't throw in a lot of, but this is just inpatient substance use treatment. There's about 9 that we have access to in our region. Sobering, we have 2, and Sobering is a unique service. This is the one that maybe most of you are familiar with, STARS Sobering, where they used to do their drop-off and detox. Well, since they moved into a new location, they've had some challenges with revamping one of their buildings, and so they've had to reduce some of the Sobering services. This was a wonderful resource for law enforcement and for the hospital to transition them from Sobering into an inpatient where they would have some time to, in a stable environment and be monitored to be able to transition. But we weren't really one of those currently. And then just withdrawal management, again, not secure. We're looking at the 5. So secure and withdrawal management, the difference there is you're detained against your will in 1, and the others just provide the same level of care, but you can't be detained to it. It's voluntary. Residential, which includes some of the housing associated, we have 3. And then youth outpatient, since the issue with Daybreak came out, we really only have 3, not including some of the, and again, I'm excluding it because it wasn't listed in some of the VHA yet, because VHA 7 2022, the private providers that do substance use work don't always report themselves in taking Medicaid services. So there's a lot more of those. I don't have those numbers available, unfortunately. And then OTP programs, we have 2. And that's the medication-assisted treatment. So just looking at, and then youth residential, especially with, affecting back in Daybreak, we have 2 now. And so this is an area we're looking to really expand and address in our region. And of course, I could provide the listing, and the BHA directory is there, hasn't been updated for 2023. This kind of gives you an idea when we talk about availability, it's not as simple as saying what is, numbers, but more about what is functionally available with access. In addition to that, we also, as ASO, run a bunch of programs to connect individuals, recognizing that as individuals are waiting to get into treatment services, there's various things you can do to support them and encourage them to go. So the Spokane VHA ASO works with the healthcare authority to run a recovery navigator program. This is a partnership with our Pioneer Human Services and law enforcement for individuals who are identified on the community, on the street, by family members, or anybody. They have a substance use or a potential substance use issue, no diagnosis is needed, and they can outreach and engage in the community, provide resource management and engagement. We also work with FPH with our homeless outreach and stabilization and transition team. It also does engagement with the community as an SUV provider on staff, be able to engage, again, without regard to insurance. The goal there is to say all individuals have access and welcome. We also run a behavioral health transitional support pilot program through VOA. 2 of the shelters here in the community. We look to connect them to resources and engagement. And then we also run a program with NAMI that provides a community engagement individual who supports families with education and knowledge about connection with the community, navigating that system. You know, families have a lot of challenges in understanding it. As I just shared, it's really complex. They help in providing that navigation. So these are just a few programs that we're running on top of the other ones for the voluntary treatment
service. So are veteran services included in this information, included in these locations?
Yeah, veterans are served, and in fact, they have a direct connection to a lot of the specific veteran services.
Okay.
Yeah, we were closely with the VA and their outreach team, We are all inclusive in this, but when veterans are identified specifically, they're immediately directed to specific resources. Jen, you talked about this, as part of our crisis services, it's a requirement that they identify individuals for veterans specifically to ensure that they're tied into resources.
A lot of information.
I know. So, and that's brief.
And I'll just quickly ask a question, it's all about fentanyl, and the influx of that. So, do these programs cover substance abuse treatment for fentanyl, or is there something more designed for people who are on fentanyl?
That's a great question. Jen can touch on this as well. So all of these programs recognize that, especially when you're engaging with someone, there can be various drugs. It could be a polysubstance issue, right? They're not just using one, they may be five different ones. The idea for fentanyl and why it's so dangerous is because of the risk associated with one use. I mean, it can be deadly immediately, and we don't know. And in fact, what we've heard is an uptick of people taking other substances, and fentanyl's mixed in, and they don't even know it. So then they are having to deal with that aspect and not recognize it. I think we're all aware that fentanyl is a major issue in our community, so all substance use providers are even more attuned to that specific need and addressing the specific treatment designed for that. I mean, it's under synthetic opioids, which has always been a treatment option available to individuals. It's just so much more deadly in a way. And so what we don't have, and this is an issue that we're working on expanding some of our other programming, is what about youth who are engaging this for the first time in preventative measures? That's an area where, until they're involved with substance use providers, how do they get access to that knowledge and information? And that's where we started a new program with the schools, Initiative for Student Wellness, school-based SBIRT, which is screening, brief intervention, referral to treatment. And this program really looks to bring it upstream, looking at students before they even engage to say, stop, what are we doing, where's the need, and how can we address it before you were interacting? One death is one student who's been on one too many.
Follow up on that, just curious, so how do you identify the students, or is it all the students that you kind of bring in and screen for likelihood of falling into that?
So in that program, we actually run that in five school districts now. We started in West Valley, we included Riverside, Freeman, East Valley, and now we've got Chi. They were smaller schools because the project was my brainchild a couple of years ago to get this going, and now it's just kind of blown up. The goal there is to do a similar survey to the Healthy Youth Survey that people may be familiar with, Department of Health. There's 250 questions in that one, it takes an hour. We held ours down, and it's a partnership with Seattle Children's, as well as Reclaiming Futures at Portland State. They targeted 26 key areas, supports, risk factors, including suicidal ideation, substance use, mental health issues, anxiety, academic performance. And what we do is partner with the school with a clinician to screen an entire grade, every student. They have to opt in, and for those that are under the age of 13, of course, parents have the decision-making capacity for the treatment side. All parents and the youth have a decision to opt in. We've had a 95% success in individuals opting in to take the survey. Once the survey is complete, they're targeted in the tiers, and then they're immediately followed up with more resources. Doesn't necessarily mean they immediately get treatment, because it may be not needed. Maybe it's prevention, maybe it's academic, maybe it's a group service. And what we found with the schools is, we were never asking those questions in that way, but providing this to the schools and then having a clinician immediately available, they found that information in West Valley that they didn't know. A lot of it had to do with bullying, potential for drug use. They had other students referring their friends outside of the school because, like, this is amazing, we're actually getting help. So, to your point there, the goal is to identify every student across that to say, it doesn't matter if you're exhibiting the symptoms now, we want to be preventative and look at them before it becomes to that point of investigation.
There's one more follow-up, I guess. What the survey you're talking about, I'd be curious to know, is that, has that been, you know, peer-reviewed studies looked at it to show that the survey itself actually, you know, come to the right conclusions, and if so, I mean, is that something that could be expanded, say across all of District 81, your first day of school, you take the survey, and boom, you hit a benchmark to kind of see what needs to be followed up on.
Yeah, so the survey that we employed in this program was in partnership with Seattle Children's and Clinton Futures, which designed this as a national standard for screening and brief intervention for the treatment. So it's a nationally recognized model, it's got peer review, it's rigorously tested, which is why we utilized it. And in fact, it's again, so clearly tied to what Department of Health is doing, dialed down to really address the care. So yes, it has all of those, which is why we utilized it. King County does this. This is kind of where we got the model from, Best Start for Kids. But what they weren't doing was the follow-up afterwards, meaning a clinician seeing them immediately after the survey was done. They just keep referring. I said, let's do that, but do it better. So we then we employed a clinician to actually do the survey and review it. So could it be done? Yes, that's how King County does it. However, we think it's important throughout the entire school year to continue to assess and see the students immediately so that when that need is identified, you don't have to wait 2 weeks, 3 weeks to get in service. They're provided it until the service is actually. The important thing about this is it's provided regardless of insurance coverage or ability to pay or their status in the community. Everyone gets it equitable and it meets all the needs.
Question about fentanyl. Is fentanyl such a unique drug and epidemic that our existing services need to tailor their approaches to that specific substance? Or does the approach we've used in the past still hold true?
Great question. I have my thoughts on that. Yeah, do you want to? So, again, when I look at substance use as a clinician myself, all substances impact individuals in a certain way, and then they have certain outcomes, right? It's an opioid. So we know that it definitely makes people feel good. That's the hard part about it, right? It is an escape to deal with an underlying issue. We're dealing there with symptomology. So that still exists. Treatment modalities exist to deal with that aspect of it. What is so much more dangerous about fentanyl is how it's being utilized in the community. And it's being mixed with things. And then it's being employed in a way which oftentimes it's a Russian roulette with the use of it. So much of the prevention is don't use this at all because death could occur. Instead of saying, let's reduce your risk, it's now saying there's risk the moment you take it, regardless. So the unique methodologies have changed. That's why you see places giving out test strips. That's your drugs we're using because you could die with this use, right? Not that that is an advocated part of what Sloan County or what we're doing here as providers. It's just another methodology that's changed in terms of responding to it. And yes, I think it does have to change because it's so the epidemic nature of it in the community and how it's influenced with other drugs causes, in our view, higher risk and longer issues with abuse. And so in that way, yes, but I would argue it still needs to be coupled with tried and true methodologies that have already been tested, right? And we know are effective and have rigorous testing to ensure that individuals receiving treatment over a course of period of time are have positive outcomes.
I would like to add to that, because I just met with Assistant Chief Lundgren and Major McNabb this morning. They were talking about this. They said the amount of fentanyl flooding into Washington is off the charts, number one. And number two, it went from $20 a pill to 50 cents a pill. So now it is so cheap that anybody can buy it. You don't have to have $20 anymore. And that makes it even more dangerous because it was available.
Yeah. No, and in that regard, it seems like more of a partnership with other, not just substitute providers can't fix this or solve this, right? It's a partnership that needs to occur across first responders with a legal system and with prevention and awareness community members. You know, so you're right.
We have about 15 minutes left.
And I apologize. This is Jan Schell.
You're all asking such excellent questions. I'm sitting here thinking I could go on forever and talk about all of these topics. Your question about workforce absolutely has been a struggle. And we were running 35% vacancy rate. We have really done a push to try to increase our workforce and stabilize the workforce. So the last data I looked at, we were at about 21% vacancy rate. For the first time since COVID, we're starting to feel that staff are coming back, they're staying, and that, you know, we're starting to feel a little more settled, but as we bring more people in, we still have people leaving. One of the things that we did at Frontier is we found that a lot of our master's level clinicians were leaving us because during COVID, they all went into private practice. And so what we did to try to stabilize that is we started to hire more people with a bachelor's degree. But then we created what we call a training academy, where we run them through 6-8 week training so that we can get them the knowledge and assist them so that they can do the kind of work that is done with the chronically mentally ill population. And we've had a lot of success with that. Unfortunately, people with a bachelor's degree, they go through our training academy, they get the experience, they love the work, and now they want to go with a master's degree. So we're still, you know, trying to figure out what is that answer so that we can recruit and retain as many staff as possible. But it's an excellent question because we're challenged by it daily. One of the things that Frontier did almost 10 years ago is that we created an access to care system where you can come in or call in for an intake appointment to get into services with us. And we did that because what we found 10 years ago is when we say to you, here's your appointment on this day at this time, 35% of the time people didn't show up. So we run 100% success rate with people coming in at a time that is convenient for them. We complete an intake, we make a decision right there and then that they are now enrolled in treatment with us. They're assigned to a clinician, they have their next appointment, and we're off and running. That has made a big difference for us in our ability to connect with people at a time when they've decided they're ready for. And that's made a big difference in their commitment to treatment as well. This issue with fentanyl, Frontier just went into partnership with the WSU for a SAMHSA grant. And the idea around that was that we would have a paramedic from the fire department and a mental health person from Frontier. And we would assist those individuals where Narcan was administered because of an overdose. And we would work closely with law enforcement because a lot of times they identify people that they've come across with overdose. And the idea behind this was at that time, we could speak with them about the possibility of treatment and the possibility of using Suboxone so that we could get them started in treatment and then link them to a treatment provider for that ongoing care for their substance use. Unfortunately, we did not get that grant, but we have been in conversation with WSU about how can we still make this happen. Frontier started several years ago with co-responder teams. You're probably familiar. We have a mental health professional that is paired with a Spokane Police Department officer or a Spokane County Sheriff Deputy. And I have a grant that is separate with Providence where I have a mental health professional with someone from the fire department, a paramedic. And their whole purpose is to contact people within our community to complete an assessment, hear what it is they are needing, and try to get them linked with services and to provide that follow-up care so that we're sure that they did make that contact, that they did get connected and are in treatment. So we've really been at the front of that because we know that there are people in our community who aren't going to show up for treatment, but we know we can find them on the streets or someone will refer them to us and we can make contact with them and try to get them into the substance treatment that they need or the behavioral health treatment. Justin mentioned there is, with Judge Peckman, there are what we call true threats, and that is what pays for our co-responder teams. We also have grants. Frontier was the only provider in all of Washington who was successful in obtaining all of the true grants. And because of that, we have an array of resources that we can provide to individuals. We just 2 weeks ago housed 24 True Blood class members in a brand new apartment complex that we built in partnership with Catholic Charities. It's called Mother Teresa, is the name of the apartment complex. So we've done that through the True Blood dollars. We also have dollars for rental subsidies up to $1,650 a month for 6 months that we can offer to individuals that are ordered into outpatient competency restoration, or they are on an identified list that the healthcare authority provides to us of individuals who have high contact with the criminal justice system. So we have a lot of resources that we use to contact these individuals and then hopefully link them to services and ensure that they maintain those services. I would say probably 80% of the individuals we contact have some type of substance use. So they go hand in hand with their mental health issues, and we're very well aware of that. And so we do provide co-occurring treatment at Frontier, but we also have these specialty programs that are designed to serve that individual who may have that higher use of substance in addition to their mental health issues. Like I said, I could go on forever, but I do want to address what you have an interest in or any questions that you have.
I have two. So I know you have your youth services.
Yes.
So around drug treatment, how are you educating, or is there a partnership you're working with around drug use? Something Councilmember Cathcart and I talk about all the time is prevention through education. That's one. And then on the co-occurring and with mental health providers, many cities on the other side of the state have beefed up their programs where there's a mental health provider with the fire department. They have found that citizens respond differently to the fire department than they do to the police department. And so they just have a more sense of safety in not being taken to jail. So from those cities, they feel the outcome has been better. So I question young people, but is there any opportunity to increase more mental health providers with our fire department going forward?
You know, those co-responder teams, definitely. We have had conversations with Justin and others about adding more mental health and paramedic teams with the fire department. And I think what you say is true. There is a different comfort level that people have when the fire department and a mental health professional show up versus law enforcement and a mental health professional. Although I must say that because we have had the co-responder teams with law enforcement for going almost 4 years now, there is a different comfort level here. And our contract with the Washington Association of Sheriff and Police Chiefs allows our team to go back and do follow-up. So someone doesn't have to call us on you. We don't have to have a current concern. We could go 2 weeks from now and go and visit that individual and just drop in and say, hi, how you doing? Anything you need? Rather than it having to be a crisis contact. And I think that's gone a long way to decrease that level of discomfort that people may have. But we are absolutely interested in pursuing more of these co-responder teams with the fire department. And legislatively, there is interest in having co-responder teams that are made up more of social workers or medical staff rather than on the law enforcement end. So I think that we'll probably end up with a balance. In terms of youth, we do provide services in schools. We are in the Valley Schools. We have what we call our WISE program, and we have 14 teams there, and these are individuals that need a high level of contact. Traditional outpatient services does not work for them. And they have substance issues, their parents have substance issues. So that is something that is absolutely incorporated in the treatment that we provide. We run groups on a regular basis that people can attend and that are based on substations.
Thank you. Another question for you, Jen. Can you remind me of the background, just the education requirements of those mental health clinicians paired with law enforcement? And can you also touch on, are there any staffing issues with those jobs?
I have two separate contracts. One is with the healthcare authority, and under that contract, I have a mix of bachelor's level clinicians and master's level clinicians. Under my WASPIC contract, they started that where it was master's level only, and you have to be a mental health professional. So that made it very challenging to recruit people. They've softened their criteria, and at this point, we can hire individuals who have a bachelor's degree or a master's degree. But there is a difference in what the bachelor's level staff can do compared to those with a master's degree. In terms of recruitment, there is no school to educate people on how to be a co-responder. So we're really looking for individuals that do well in a crisis situation, who can engage with anybody in any age group, and who have behavioral health issues, substance issues, domestic violence issues. So we need people that are really generalists in some degree so that they can work with anybody that they encounter. Right now, we are looking at our process to hire individuals. One of the things all of our staff have to go through is a background check with the Spokane Police Department. And we're looking at that to see if there might be some leeway with that, because some of the questions are pretty challenging in a mental health environment. We're two very different disciplines, and so some of the questions are not typically what we would ask in for a mental health employee.
Quick follow-up. So of the current positions, are there any openings, or how many openings are there filled?
Right now, I have 6 filled, and I have a total of 9.
Oh. You're not thinking of jumping ship here.
I happen to have an application right here.
We have one more room for okay. One more question. Okay.
So I hope this makes sense, but I've been fascinated with this idea since I heard about it. The mental health first aid classes?
Yes.
So I understand that those are being conducted. My question is, has anybody talked about, and I know there are some safety issues to this, but providing some of those classes to the general public? And I ask that just because those of us, I mean, I know a lot of people that are downtown and they see somebody having a crisis. And they would help if they knew what to do, but I also know that can be dangerous.
Yeah. Frontier offers mental health first aid, and in fact, we have staff that are trained as trainers.
Okay.
They're certified to train mental health first aid. And before the pandemic, we were offering classes, you know, monthly and maybe even a few times a month. We have started to do that again, now that we can all be together in a room. And we train anyone. We have had faith-based individuals come for training. We've had different agencies in town, banks, you know, any walk of life has come to these training, and they all find it very beneficial because it's done in layman's terms, and so the concepts are really easy to grasp onto, and it does provide you with here's a situation, what could your interaction be like, what kind of questions would you ask, or if you saw a person, what might you notice that would give you an idea of maybe what they might be going through.
Such a great idea, and I would if it somewhere we've got to involve our neighborhood councils, especially those that are dealing with a lot of situations in their neighborhoods and their parks. It would be,
it's a little scary to me.
Okay. Well, and I know there's that whole thing.
It's an excellent class.
Yeah, I just think it would be really beneficial.
Yeah, I think
I'm not sure I'm still certified to teach it, but I used to, and I absolutely recommend it. So happy to train you here.
Okay.
Yeah, it's great.
All right. Jan, both of you, thank you so much.
Thank you, that was great.
Thank you so much. Great learning experience for all of us, so thank you. Councilmember Sapone, I forgot, I know you're up there. I see you, the ZZ up there.
I am good, thank you.
Okay, thanks, appreciate it. All right, thank you so much.
And we are condolences for loss of Jeff.
Is Jen Saraswati's HHOS grant award cycle update, and you're going to tell us what that acronym is too.
Jacoby, are you able to paint? Okay, so
Jen, that microphone kept getting,
I think it might be better off like that. Okay. So I'm here to talk about our HHOS portfolio. And HHOS stands for Homeless Housing Operations and Services. It's also known as our five-year award. So these are the dollars that we put out as a five-year award. And so I want to provide some context as to what we've been working on in the last year. If you could go to the next slide, please. Okay, so we've been working with our board to put out a new notice of funding availability for these funds. And we plan to do that on September 8th. And that is going to include our CHG, which is our Consolidated Homeless Grant, 10, which is Housing and Essential Needs, HSG, which is the Homeless Services Grant, which is city general fund dollars that are committed to services, HHAA, which is our Homeless Housing Assistance Act, and ESG, which is our Emergency Shelter Grant. All of these, with the exception of ESG, are state or local dollars. So the CHG and HEN dollars come from the state, and the HSG and the HHAA are local dollars that come through the city of Spokane. ESG is part of our entitlement package. However, it's specific for homeless services, so we're not including that in the home and CDBG RFP that's out, because it's really just a completely different bucket of funding. The estimated total for these funds is $7,600,000 annually, again, from federal, state, and local sources. The ESG dollars, which are the only federal sources, are only $240,746, so it's a very, very small portion of that. We are proposing a contract term of 3 years, beginning July 1st of 2024 and ending June 30th of 2027. One of the reasons that we did this is because the Department of Commerce, which is a huge bucket of our funding, operates on a two-year cycle. And we're currently ending our existing five-year grant award right in the middle of the two-year commerce cycle. And so our hope is to align with that commerce cycle by going to a three-year award, which would allow us to get through the current two-year cycle and then through an additional two-year cycle. We intend to fund projects using the following prioritization guidelines, which were developed through our board, which is that the applications must support the Spokane City and County 2020-2025 Strategic Plan to Prevent and End Homelessness, and have data-driven funding priorities that will be informed, by the 2023 CHHS Community Needs Survey. I said see attached, but it's actually, I need to actually attach it into the folder. I think I had forgotten to do that. So you can kind of look at that. I did review that at our board meeting, but I don't think I've ever done that in front of council. And so I can send you that information to help you kind of see what some of the community members were saying they wanted to spend these dollars on. We did release a pre-notice, and we plan to put out the NOPA, as I mentioned, on September 8th. And could you go to the next slide, Jacoby?
Yep.
These are the total current awards based upon year five. So we're currently in year five. It started July 1st of this year. The one thing I want to call out, I'm sorry, I was actually scheduled to do this next week, and then I got notice I was bumped up. So the very last CCEW, which is Catholic Charities, for $242,377 should actually be $240,746. So I was slightly off on that. But you can see who we've awarded here. And
actually, we can't.
Oh, I'm sorry, because it's an eye chart, yes. Hopefully you can review the actual details of that after this meeting. Thank you. We'll get that a little bit closer. So we have a wide variety of services that are paid for through this. There are diversion dollars, street outreach, emergency shelter, transitional housing, rapid rehousing. We have some supportive services only, permanent supportive housing, coordinated entry.
I go back up, oh no, to stay there and go to 772, which is SNAP for 173,000 street outreach. So are you, how are you asking for performance measures? How do we know that this is actually working or being effective?
Absolutely. So,
Or even happening at all.
Or happening at all. Yes. So, so we do know that the services are happening because we get monthly billings that we review, and they have to submit various documentation that shows what work that they're doing. They're also required to submit quarterly reports. This is linked to back in kind of June. I came to you because we were going into the fifth year of the five-year awards, and you all wanted to see what were the outcomes that were associated with these different project types. And we did a presentation on that to talk about where these different projects were at in terms of their hitting certain percentages. Sorry, my daughter probably wants more time on her iPad. we'll start next week. And so we reviewed those specific percentages of where people were at meeting metrics like exits to permanent housing, number of people served, how long they were staying in shelters, all of that. So I'm glad to forward that presentation back on if you want to look at what those metrics look like. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, I didn't interrupt.
Oh,
when you're done with your
thought. Okay. And so we are not actually at this point proposing that we continue these on, right? We're in the last, we've already authorized the last year of the five-year awards, which would go through June 30th of 2024. But I wanted you to get an idea of what this has been funding. Can you go to the next slide, Jacoby? So when you look at the buckets that we have here, we have our CHG funds. And so I've kind of given you an overview here of what is eligible in each one of these categories. So you can see what can be funded in each one. I do want to call out on the very right-hand side there, the HEN category. That is a very specific type of program that involves qualifying through DSHS. And so all of the activities that are in HEN are awarded to a HEN provider who does all of those things. So we wouldn't typically see that you would award a HEN transitional program to one organization and a HEN homeless prevention to another organization. That package kind of comes together. You could have multiple providers who do a HEN project, but they would have to provide all of those services. The other ones, you could apply to just do one. So you, in CHG, you could say, well, I'm just going to do emergency shelter, or I'm only asking for transition. So I just wanted to call out that difference. HHAA and our HSG are our most flexible funds, and they have the capability to be used for, they just have a lot less guidelines that come along with them because there are local dollars. And then you can see that these are overseen by our CHHS board, and the RFP committee reviews those, and then the Spokane City and County five-year strategy. Can you go to the next slide, please? So the next thing I have on here is ESG. And so as I mentioned, that's a really small bucket. And it's a little bit funky because it actually falls underneath our five-year consolidated plan, but it is connected to our five-year strategy to end homelessness. It is also part of that plan, but it technically comes via our entitlement award, so it lives there. And these are the activities that go along with it. So my goal in coming today was really to be able to provide you an update of where we were at in issuing a new NOFA for these sets of funds. I also did want to have the opportunity to address the regional authority and the potential of that being implemented. And I have heard some concerns about tying up some of these funds during a three-year period. I don't think personally that it makes sense to do a single year RFP given the volume of and types of projects. So one of the other things that we could potentially look at doing is, would we want to extend the existing contracts for one additional year, which would align us with the commerce cycle and allow that time for the regional authority to kind of come into fruition and determine what they want to do for that next two-year cycle. So that's an option for us as well. So at this point, we've been proceeding with the idea of putting out this NOFA on September 8th for a three-year cycle. But I wanted to have the opportunity to get feedback on that and some direction.
Councilman, any thoughts?
Go
Can you clarify why 1 year doesn't make sense?
It is a huge volume of applications. So if you look at that list that we have, to do an application for 1 year for that volume of funds is just very time consuming, not only from a staffing level perspective, which is why they went to the 5 year award, but also from a reviewing perspective, from our board that is reviewing it, and then for agencies that have to put together application processes for a single year's worth of funding. So I would say the minimum we would want to do would be a 2 year, but the 2 year doesn't make sense in this because then it ends us smack dab right in the middle of the commerce cycle again.
So you're recommending a 3 year?
I'm recommending a 3 year or an extension of 1 year of the existing contracts until we can align with whatever happens with the regional authority.
And I remember when we went to that 5 year for you, I don't think anybody else was.
Yeah, I was a part of it. Yeah, I like the 3 year, and I do. It's huge. It's a big lift for especially those volunteer committee members that sit on boards and commissions. That board that has to, and I can't imagine that's a lot of work to do once a year. All the time. I mean, you'd be doing it all the time.
Right.
Go ahead, Councilor Wood.
Well, it's not only the work on this end, but for nonprofits who are doing that right. work. That five-year goal was to help stabilize it without spending every year certain amount of pay to write a grant, which can be extremely expensive. So it allows them to do the work and to do some future planning without chasing dollars every 3 months. And that's critical to them.
Question for you, Jen. As far as the street outreach, we know relationship building is so important. Is it possible as part of these applications in the past or thinking in the future awarding funds to an organization that will focus geographically on a location or trying to figure out an organization working just with one group of folks, another organization working with another, so that there's not so much overlap? Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's something that we could prioritize in the application process. As we went through our process of identifying priorities, that wasn't something that came up, but it's certainly something that we could evaluate. And I know that the review committee, as they look at services, one of the goals is to ensure that there's not duplicative type services that are overlapping.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I guess I would just say it would be concerning to me to do a 3 year, given that we need to put money into the regional authority, assuming that comes together. And so I would be more interested in an extension, but I would only want to extend if we could add some additional requirements, some additional sidebars, and have some metrics in there to really make sure that something's happening. I couldn't tell you anything that's been accomplished with these organizations, and it'd be great to have some like really finite details to see what the successes have been, to know that we want to reauthorize those.
Well, from a provider standpoint, that would sound like a whole new RFP to put that in, and it would change. So it wouldn't be a 1 year extension. You're doing a whole new contract
sure.
at that point, you're going through the whole process. And I don't know how we could legally do that, or if those providers would still want to play with us, giving those additional requirements. So I understand what you're saying.
I'm thinking about things like if it's a shelter, for example, you must provide hourly updates as to your capacity or our live dashboard. Just simple things that a lot of these folks are still not doing.
Well, let's find out from Jen if we can get those report those. Performance measures.
Yes, I can send the performance measures back out.
First, and then we can determine
okay.
if it's actually happening or not.
Yeah, and I think the thing that I'd like to include in that is that it is not just the performance measures for these projects, but what is the performance for all of those types of projects across our system? Because the performance measures, I would say, in general, across our community, we're not necessarily hitting those benchmarks that were put into the five-year strategy, which is in the process of being updated. It also ends in 2025, so it's also a good segue to that update as well. But we are making progress as a community, and some of the things that impact performance measures are out of our control,
sure.
right? Like the housing market and some of those other things. So I'm glad to provide that information again. In terms of what is being reported on and what we have asked for folks to do.
But on that, if somebody's working in housing and they're telling us they can house X number of people, and at the end of the year they say, oh, well, the housing market didn't improve, so we didn't get there. Like, that should have been a part of their calculation up front, not yeah. as a way to explain away why they weren't able to accomplish what they had promised us they were going to accomplish.
And I think one of the hard things is that, and this is one of the challenges we saw with 5 years, especially 5 years that started pre-COVID and ended post-COVID, is that significant amounts of things changed during that time frame. And I would like to call out that one of the challenges that we faced as well was that during that time frame, almost the entire department left. And so the ongoing management and possible adjustment of those contracts was not happening, right? And then we're just now getting staff up to speed where we can spend more time focusing and providing technical assistance to help make sure that those quarterly reports are being submitted. There was nobody there asking for those. There was nobody there processing those. And that's something that happened on our end. So I absolutely agree. I think that holding folks accountable to performance measures is really important. I do want to caution that that what you're proposing does, it would be easier to go into a new RFP cycle because then we're able to open it up, evaluate, provide performance measures based on the new normal, and not kind of negotiate on an individual by individual contract. The other thing that I want to throw out there, and I think there's pros and cons to both of it, is that by extending for a year, it does limit the access to organizations that were not awarded in that five-year cycle. And it means that those organizations are still out potentially an additional year before they can access those funds. But I mean, like I said, there's pros and cons to both. And we do have clauses in our contracts that allow us to exit based on certain things. And within the pre-notice I put out, I did say that length of contract may be impacted by the development of a regional authority. But I also just want to be cognizant of saying, hey, we're doing a three-year award. Oh, and in year two, we might pull all that back.
Could that be in the contract essentially that says, you know, hey, if this is established by such and such date, you will not receive the award for year three or two or whatever it is?
Yeah, I think I would like to have a little more guidance maybe from the regional group in terms of what that language would look like if they plan to extend those contracts. We have a clause that says that we can give notice for, essentially no cause notice for a variety of different reasons. So I don't know. So there's a lot to think about. Our committee is prepared to move forward with 3 year and we can move that direction, but I wanted to have the opportunity to connect with council on that.
And I appreciate that. My concern would be if that's written in the contract, we might pull back funding if this is established. Would that, in some ways, hurt the development of a regional authority and these other organizations' willingness to engage and participate fully? We need them.
Back to data collecting. So I know a couple years back we were concerned every provider didn't have the same technology to report real-time bid accessibility.
Yep.
And it was a technology problem. Where are we in that? Did we ever get there because there was the cost of the equipment and training?
Well, we were told it had to go into their contracts.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
why I brought it up.
So are we all there?
So I would say that we do not have real-time reporting at all. We have the Shelter Me Spokane web portal, which is updated daily typically, where they input data about bed availability. It's not real time. And none of our, even CMIS is not real time. There is not a mechanism right now that exists for us to be able to do real time data. We're usually within 24 to 48 hours.
I'm gonna disagree. It'd be so easy. One person is assigned to send a text message to a number at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. This is not rocket science. Although we do this. This is super simple stuff.
Right. And I appreciate that. I just understand that we work with this population. We have some folks that say, I understand that. And then change their minds. So you have staff.
Hence the need for the lives.
I agree. I agree with you. I want to understand. I understand that it is, there is some complexity.
Okay, we are going to move on because we have one more item.
Right. Sure. So the only thing I would like to say is at this point, unless we receive direction otherwise, we will proceed with releasing the RFP for a three-year time period next Friday. And so if there's any additional guidance, please reach out to myself or Kim McCollum and we can adjust.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Next up is Matt Boston. And we get to talk about ARPA Tuesday, we won't be talking to her.
Yeah.
At the end of 2024.
Welcome, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you.
Two different things we're talking about. First, we're going to talk about the youth behavioral health NOPA that's going to be released. This is something that Council Member Zappone has been working on with the committee. The administration ARPA work group has been working on this. They finalized the NOPA. It's been distributed to all of you earlier this morning for your review. Fits the spirit and intent of the original allocation that was made. Just as in review, this notice of funding availability is to solicit applications from behavioral health organizations that have the capacity to expand their already existing services to at-risk youth. This program's purpose is to provide lasting capital dollars, which is the key component to that, to assist in construction project or expansion of an existing facility. The overall award is $1 million. I know that the work group currently is working on implementing it into the Neighborly program. So based on everything going according to plan and there being no significant changes or objections with this group here, that is the timeline that's been laid out that the administration, Michelle Murray's group, is comfortable with.
Did everybody hear him?
Yeah, I can.
Okay.
No problem. So moving along, the higher level of why we're really here today is talking about the ARPA allocations that have been made thus far, reviewing the programs of the allocations for either stagnation in the process or failure of a competitive bidding process. And just seeing what funds we're interested in bringing back into the hopper to reallocate, as we know that we have to do that from a timing issue. We have to do that before 12/31/2024. They don't have to be spent until 12/31/2026. But as a little bit over a year seems like an eternity away, it tends to take some time to get these reallocated, go out for competitive bidding, as well as evaluate the current needs that we have. So it's reviewing kind of all of the projects and the programs thus far for status. So we'll just see on this very high level chart that Michelle Murray put together, we have the roughly $81 million award that we received, less revenue replacement of 35.5 that has been allocated and a significant amount spent. 44.2 in community support and then 900,000 in administrative support, leaving about 400,000 unallocated. You know that there's a lot of need and ask for that $400,000 plus. So the purpose of this exercise, as well as in tandem with next week's meeting, is to identify not only what the full amount that we have available, if it stays at that $400,000 or grows, but what other priorities can we identify? That said, I think we can move to the next slide. So this is going into those different buckets of revenue replacement, community support, and administration, and identifying the ones that are either stagnant in the process right now, had a failed RFP or NOFA award, they're no longer needed in their original thought. So capital municipal justice, we know that was a $5 million award that was meeting the need for the municipal courts to end up in a new facility based on the space needs that they currently have. Those space needs have not been solved. There was discussions with the administration back in April of this current year to say, based on the Primera purchase failing and no longer moving forward, to use some of those funds to identify almost a stencil of sorts of what the municipal courts needs and where they can move in within the city. We have yet to receive that from the administration.
I believe the request was that Innovia was going to be Integris was going to be doing that work because they had a lot of source matter expertise on the organization as a whole, as well as a lot of our capital facilities, City Hall being one of them. I know Garrett Jones is in conversations with Howard Delaney about what that could look like if there's a move over into some of the City Hall space, at least on an interim basis. So while there's $4.9 million available, in theory, there could be a need for municipal courts needing some of that money for a capital improvement if they do move to City Hall. We can't just fit them in the current space that we have. I think we're waiting to get that evaluation. The alternative is to use the Monroe Court and lease out some space. But if we do that as an organization, it's a short-term band-aid that is long-term more money, because we don't necessarily incur the cost savings that we get when we own the building and it's off the property tax roll. So in theory, we're paying for a lease where the property manager, property owner is paying property taxes and thus charging the city of Spokane in that process.
I just wanted to mention one thing. When talking to Garrett, we talked about this City Hall as a possibility. The cost to make that work would be very high. It would have to have a dedicated elevator. The security system would be completely reconfigured. Mm-hmm. The spaces would have to be segregated so that the jail population is isolated from. It just goes on and on, and it's busy thinking about it. So I'd rather we not think about that as an option unless the miracle happens. But we also need to recognize that we own other buildings over there, such as the Gardner Building, and there can be, and that was originally supposed to be community court. Mm-hmm. So there might be other things that we could trade off.
Doesn't that require a lot of upgrades, the Gardner Building?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we did
some upgrades, remember? Yeah. We have, and the only problem is, yes, I mean, to both of your points, any move, any space expansion that the courts are going to need are going to require capital costs, especially if we own the building.
Yeah.
And that's why the question is when you're looking at that, a lot of people think, well, we backed out of the Primera deal, we went no further on that. Therefore, can we sweep this $5 million back? Well, we haven't solved the need that courts has. If we enter into a multi-year lease, and it could be thought of as money wasted at that point.
Yeah, just be an increased cost rather than a long-term money saver is what we
long-term need. Yeah,
so,
right.
And I wouldn't discount the Primera building because there are so many options with it too. We could lease parts of it, buy it as parts of it, or lease it and sublease parts of it. I mean, there are all different options that I feel like we haven't explored yet. But I'm getting you off track.
No, and I think that's just the caveat with this line item.
So, but on that, the study is ongoing, correct? Of City Hall to look at fitting municipal court. I believe that was authorized last April, May. I mean.
From what I've been told is that they're waiting for other projects to get done before that study starts.
Okay.
That's the update I've been given.
Okay, so nothing's happening on that front. Okay, well, I mean, I think at the end of the day, though, like, we got to make a decision pretty darn soon on what we're doing with that. And if it is going to be to upgrade City Hall, we need to know, how.
Right.
So maybe we need to get that study going, ASAP. And if not, if we're not going to do City Hall, then we got to find another solution. That will be a money saver.
Or at least break even.
But provide them what they need.
Yeah.
Well, I think the challenge has been with the courts. It's just kind of been this ongoing. It's like, when do they have to be out? I don't have a deadline. It's like, it's just a conversation. Is there some type of timeline?
It's not that they necessarily have to be out. It's more that they're expanding out of the space that we have within the county campus. Monroe Court is a building that's adjacent to the county campus. So that's
3-year lease.
Right, and it's the most viable option just because of the ease of getting to and from. That's, I think, I believe that's why Primera was thought of, because it was a full package of everything can be moved off of county campus and off of Monroe Court to all happen there. Obviously, when moving all of the operations over off a secure campus, you have to think about the costs that are associated with that. I think Howard Delaney could probably give a little bit more insight on what the urgency of the need is. I think we could have a conversation with Howard Delaney and Garrett Jones. But I don't think, when looking at that 4.9, I mean, I just want to be realistic. Yes, you could pull that back, but you have not solved the municipal court's problem, of which was the spirit and intent of allocating the $5 million was to solve the court's problem that the council had addressed.
And it's not just a space issue, it's a safety issue.
That's correct.
Also, we really need to look at a drug court. We don't have a drug court.
Yeah.
And that will be the next expansion.
Well, I thought they applied for a grant to do it. Maybe there's
no have a court. We didn't qualify.
We don't have space.
So with all this going on, that is something that I'm sure Howard will be bringing to us again as part of the expansion instead of a drug court.
Well, my crazy audacious idea is, let's partner. I know it's the opposite direction of what we've been doing. Let's partner with district court and have a night court all night, 24 hours, so we can expedite the process, and maybe that space can be used for drug court.
Hopefully we'll be as crazy as a TV show.
I was gonna say night court, a baby's file.
Crazy audacious.
So, well, Matt, just quickly, some of those, that hasn't been updated. They've been allocated, not spent. Like, we haven't gave the money to the truck yet.
So
it's still just over there.
Right.
Really have an update on ADU fees. None of that money's been spent that we're aware of.
It has been spent. It just hasn't been charged to the specific line item.
Okay.
So many of these things, I mean, fire capital, police capital is a prime example. We've entered into the purchase agreement of purchasing that capital, but delivery has not been completed yet.
So all that money's kind of spoken for, yeah, with the exception of the municipal justice, where that's the one that's kind of wonky.
Right. Zach, I see your hand up.
Zach, Councilmember.
Yeah, that.
Go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. That kind of answers my question. I was wondering about, like, projects of citywide significance. I thought that was all depleted already, and then seeing the remaining.
It is. All applications have their applications that have been approved, and Steve McDonald's in the room, have been approved, but waiting for project completion to distribute the funds.
Yeah, that's true, and it's like, okay. It's okay. Likely that some of that's going to come back. Some of the projects that have applied, they have a time limit. I believe it's in October, that they have to meet a certain standard. If they don't, then that money frees up for other projects that are on that
list. That are already on the list, yeah. So there are projects that are in the approval queue that are not funded that would immediately go to if the time has been passed.
That's correct.
So as you can see, I mean, with $10.2 million remaining, the bulk of that is going to be the Capitol Municipal Justice Center that was originally intended, and then the remaining bulk of that is costs that we know are coming, that they are approved, that we're just waiting on. So there's not a lot to take from the revenue replacement. Community support is a little bit different, just because there's been a lot of conversation. I apologize, I don't know what happened there with but you can back into that number. It's, you know, it's a $2 million number, roughly thereabouts, to leave $2 million left. So there's two different colors on this, there's many different colors, so hopefully you're not going crazy there. But the green is something I'll touch on in just a bit. The red is similar to what we were talking about. It's in that gray area it's either in that gray area or it's been a failed search. So let's just start at the top. The mobile medical, $1.2 million, there has been a search that went out about a year ago, only one respondent, and that was considered a failed search. Eviction defense, same thing. There was actually no respondents on that one. So 1.5 essentially back into the hopper if unless you would like to revisit that and redistribute the RFP. Youth behavioral health, And any of the council members that are leading any of these groups, please feel free to jump in, either interrupt me or do it at the end. Youth Behavioral Health, Zach, this one's you. There is $3 million that was originally allocated. $300,000 that you see in the amount encumbered and awarded is the one that is going to the partnership with school. Another $1 million, of which the RFP we just discussed, is going out. So while it says 2.7, I really imagine that as 1.7 at this point in time. Down payment assistance for $2 million. That was that revolving home loan that we were going to do to partner with Habitat for Humanity. The only reason that that one hasn't gone out is originally we had planned on piggybacking off of a CHHS contract that was for affordable housing. But knowing that it was going to just go from the affordable housing bucket, as reported to the feds, tied a significant amount of long-term reporting. And quite frankly, that wasn't something that we were able to do because this project could go on in perpetuity. Because remember, if you sell your house within the 30 years of having the mortgage, that those funds come back to the fund and then go to another recipient of those funds. So in doing some digging with both Michelle Murray and myself, we were able to find other municipalities across the state that have done that similarly. They actually swept it back into the general fund and allocated it out of the general fund from a direct allocation. As long as you're within your procurement guidelines of the general fund, it's permissible and you don't have to do the long-term reporting on it, the federal long-term reporting on it.
It's the down payment assistance. It's red.
There's no contract. We did a sole source. We did a sole source announcement
with Habitat
okay. Some time ago. And then since then, we have been doing the due diligence on what is reporting going to look like on this one, because this is the only complicated one where we're not just having a loan, but we're having a loan that's revolving
right.
over the years. So it could come back. I mean, there could be money that comes back in 10 years that then goes 30 years on top of that. And then, I mean, it could just
be
this revolving cycle.
But Habitat, we committed to Habitat.
We have not signed anything. We have just said that it is our interest to do a sole source with Habitat for Humanity.
Okay.
So there's no contract. There's been some verbal commitments, but nothing beyond that.
Okay.
Going down the list, small businesses, $5 million originally allocated, just over $1 million in the original tranche. Remember, we did two tranches of these. The second tranche is getting wrapped up right now. And there is an amount spent that's encumbered. Realistically, I would say that amount that's available, in talking to Caleb, who is the program manager on this one, is probably going to be about $500,000, give or take. The application period is closing today at 5 p.m., so we can't give a firm yes or no on that $500,000, but he is comfortable with that amount.
But the rest of it then would be allocated to the small business?
Yes.
Okay.
Everything would be allocated to those small businesses. Now again, could you bring that money back and still reshape things to small business support in a different way from the original NOFAs that went out? That is something that's possible to do to meet the spirit and the intent of the actual line item that was originally allocated of the $5 million to say, okay, we tried to allocate this $5 million. We only got, you know, $4 to $4.5 million out. Is there something that we're missing? Did we miss the mark with some of our businesses there? Neighborhood business districts, $2.5 million awarded. There has been a lot of community outreach on this one, of what exactly neighborhood district support means and how it looks like and how it's equitably distributed. There's Garland that wants something completely different than Hilliard, that wants something completely different than Kendall, that wants something completely different than Perry. How do you define a neighborhood business district? So there's a lot of complication in that $2.5 million. I know Zach and Steve have been heavily involved in that community outreach. Yeah.
Yeah, and the bid concept is still one that's floating, and I'm still very interested in, because at least it's kind of a rising tide,
right.
Not a one-time, it's done. So. But we're still exploring that, but I know there's some growing interest in some areas in my district.
Right.
And Garland's meeting I'm meeting with them end of September.
Regarding this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they don't want the bid. So we're just, it's the same, it's that same
right.
challenge.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's, I think that.
They want streetlights.
Well, that's the thing, is some neighborhoods want streetlights and infrastructure, direct infrastructure provided to their community. Some want a bid that they can have this revolving loan. Zach, I see your hand up.
Council members.
Yeah, I have to. Yeah, I have to jump in. I guess for all of these, I think this is similar to the municipal court where we've made a commitment and there's been an issue addressed in the community for all of these. I mean, maybe not eviction defense or the mobile medical, but most of these, there's been a lot of work, a lot of outreach, and a lot of work going on with these stakeholders to try to come to something that everyone's on board with. And I don't think it's also accurate to say that Garland as a whole doesn't want it, or anybody as a whole doesn't want a bid. I think there's still just a lot of outreach and they want to move forward with discussions. But they also, and I think within the bid or the neighborhood business district funding, that it can be done to have both capital projects and sustainable ones. The last we left meeting after we did our town halls and talking to staff was we were going to do a small business or a small contract to do outreach to come up with what those concrete things would be. We did a survey that showed that there was interest across all the neighborhood business districts. With youth behavior health, I want that $1.7 million that's left over. The small group, it's not just me, it's also been Councilmember Cathcart and Councilmember Kinnear. We talked about doing a second round of expansion for a capital project and then $700,000 for a teen center. There's been a roundtable discussion of about 15 providers, and we're getting ready to do a youth outreach to figure out what they want. So I think there's just been a lot of work on these that I'm hesitant about pulling back because we've made a commitment to the community.
Yeah, I in no way am trying to imply that this is something that these are any of these other than the mobile medical, the evictions defense, and some of the administrative costs that are going to be on the next slide are guaranteed drawbacks, nor do I even think mobile medical and eviction defense are guaranteed drawbacks. I think they are part of an overall discussion of saying, okay, we know that we have to allocate these by 12/31/2024. We know that there are continuing needs. And we also know, just because I will say it, that there was a commitment made in an RFP that went out for homelessness services at the Trent shelter to be supported by Trent, or to be supported by ARPA. Obviously, with only $400,000 being available, something is going to have to be swept back to fund anything past a half of the month. So that's the only reason that I'm bringing all of these into the grander conversation, is having the larger conversation of, A, timing-wise, can we get these projects that we know that there's a lot of traction and interest, but B, are they the highest needs within the city? And that's all I'm posing on my side.
Hey, Matt.
Yep.
How frequently are we going to be getting updates on some of this stuff? For example, childcare.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen any updates, and I've reached out to some providers who told me that it's been very slow and trying to get anything out or to them. I've not talked to CME directly, but I'm just curious. Do we have updates? Do you know what's happening?
We're getting up, but we can have Michelle and Caleb and Vlad do an update. I know that they're very hands-on with the actual providers that are out there, that are especially the third-party providers, Spokane Arts, and the child care provider, to bring some in. I know that there was a bit of an update, gosh, I think it was last month, where some of the providers came out and talked about impacts of the ARPA dollars. So I can put that request through and say, hey, this is something that we need to get updates on. Not only are the ones that we're talking about, but the other ones. I mean, the ones that we're talking about are more internal within council because they haven't necessarily gone out to contract.
Well, and then contractually, how is it written in terms of the data that we get back? So, for example, I would like to know every penny on childcare that is spent in my district or spent by a individual who lives in my district.
Mm-hmm.
And I know those were some of the requirements that were in the contracts, but when are we going to get that data?
I can ask.
Okay.
I can ask. I can't give you a firm answer, but I can definitely ask, and I know that they're gathering.
Big picture, when the $82 million is completely gone and ARPA's done and all that, it'd be nice to be able to look back and to the penny be able to measure exactly
what,
where, who, how,
where the impact was
across the board.
Yeah, absolutely.
So Matt?
Yes.
How much longer do you?
Just, I will go very, very quick. So just multicultural centers. Again, this is another one that there's been a lot of community outreach. There's a lot of demand for it. There's no question. In the original narrative that was attached to the funding, it was going to either multiple organizations or one building that was going to be shared by multiple organizations. That doesn't seem to be the interest of the community outreach that's going on right now. Moving to the next slide.
Wait, you're just doing red.
Yep, I'm just doing red, and I'll talk to you about it in just a second. And then administrative support legal, that's our eligibility contract. The ARPA work group within the administration is comfortable and confident with the eligibility work that they'll be able to do. So while it says $100,000 is encumbered, they've only really spent about $10,000, so you can think about $110,000 is coming back. $120,000 for the engagement, community engagement coordinator is being swept back. That was for Joy and Annalise's position, the replacement for those, of which with the administrative team and how awesome that they've done, we didn't see the need for having that.
And administrative support, is that the equity navigators?
No, so the administrative support is the Caleb Vlad, previously Michaela, that team that Michelle Murray is handling.
Got it.
Yeah. So this is just summing them all out. And then last is that green line. So the affordable housing, as it's green, it doesn't necessarily mean that you can sweep that back. But because there's $5 million, just remember this is the award that went out last year that was roughly $6 million of ARPA. Three-ish million of 1590 and $1 million of 1406 dollars. The idea there is we have a surplus of 1590 dollars that's available that we could put into the either full, we could either recategorize the full six or the $5 million that hasn't been spent to sweep that back into the ARPA kitty, but put 1590 in for the affordable housing, of which that those funds are meant for. And that is, I know we're running short on time, so.
And the ARPA money, the affordable housing ARPA money would then go to fund the track, at least part of it, the track that the 1590 money would take the place of the ARPA money for the affordable housing.
Oh, is that the plan?
Yeah.
Well, it's not. I mean, it's a thought. It's a thought of step one is identifying what is an opportunity to bring back into the hopper of funds. Step two is to say, okay, is there an interest of moving any of this money to support Trent? Step three is saying, okay, of which whatever is not going to support Trent, what will those initiatives be? I know there was a strong support for downtown bathrooms for some. I know that there was strong support for business transfer. So there's a lot of initiatives that were identified previously, and there's also new initiatives and needs that are identified right now. So it's bringing everything back into the hopper and then seeing what is being
open, obviously, to the dialogue. But it seems to me that specifically, if it's basically supplanting 1590, what's the difference of just spending 1590 on track?
But we have
restrictions
to getting 1590.
I don't support doing that, but it seems to me like that's exactly what we're doing. We're just supplanting.
Yes.
To have the exact same
but we're spending 1590 money where it should be spent. That's on
it has to be spent on affordable housing, but I get exactly what you're saying.
No, right. It is. It's like,
yeah. It's,
but
it's
still
chess pieces
one
around
time money for ongoing
expenses.
That
and so that leads into the next conversation of saying, okay, how long, I mean, there's conversations with the regional homelessness group, as Jen just discussed, of how much time and funding you attach to the Trent shelter and homelessness operations as a whole. You know, the general fund was never meant to maintain a homelessness shelter. It being $10 million a year, is a significant burden. I mean, it is almost 5% of the overall general fund expenditures if it were to be absorbed within the general fund. So that is on top of the structural gap that we already see with our labor costs and costs of just general goods and services. That makes it even more difficult that your structural gap is widening even further. You know, the mouth of that structural gap is widening even further. So theory is, do you want to fund it for a finite period of time to propose to the state, hey, next legislative session, if you want this to go any further after, you know, after funding has run out, it has to be support of the state legislator and or the regional homelessness group. And so I think that that's part of the conversation of what are we willing to pull back to fund for Trent, because there was, like I said earlier, there was an RFP that was sent out that said ARPA will be the identified funding source. In that vein, we have got to sweep back to spend some of that, or we're going to be funding 2 weeks of it and then be dead in the water after that.
It's a no-win situation.
It is a no-win.
However, I got
you're doing a really good job. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Well, I just have to say out loud, whatever those conversations were that we were not all privy to, that track would be funded by ARPA money, that was just verbal communications between certain people where the entire council had no idea that that had been put out there. So I do have some consternations that we're being held accountable and committed to something that we had no idea about, we had no input about, and had no vote on about that amount of money. Not just saying that in the story.
But the problem
that,
is
but the problem is it.
May, we have a building with people in it.
Yeah.
If you close the building, the people will go out of the building and they go everywhere. They go downtown, they go to the river, they go everywhere, and they don't get the treatment, the services. We don't have a choice. We have to find
them. Councilmember, I'm not disagree with that. I'm just saying commitments were made outside of the council process. And that's a frustrating thing.
And I am covering lots of commitments that were made outside of the council club. This is just the tip of the iceberg.
But let's be realistic. We're going to, the temple closed and went to various neighborhoods. It is a challenge that we're going to be faced with, whether the track is open or not. It'll just be to what degree that happens in our community. That's not what I want to see. That's just our reality.
That's why I said we're rock, hard place. And we have, and I know it looks a little bit like bait and switch with the ARPA funds in 1590, but we have to fund at least a half a year of track. We'll get commerce money in July, 1.7 million.
Commerce money, yes, commerce money has been attributed to us in the tune of 1.75 that can be spent as of July 1.
Yeah.
Doesn't necessarily have to be for track.
But we should be working on closing track and getting something more.
Well, transitional housing would be a lot cheaper.
Yes, yeah. It would.
So, the next steps is we're planning on having another meeting next week talking about this exact topic. If you have additional questions for myself, administrative team, council leads, please grab us between now and then so we can go through the exercise of deciding. So that we can go through the exercise of what there is at least an appetite of pulling back.
And I would recommend that we come next week with some concrete ideas. We can't vote in this session, but we can give Matt some concrete feedback.
We could put something on a committee rather quickly. I think it would definitely help administration to have an idea of, as we're going into the budget season, idea of if there is going to be contributions to Trent, what that will look like. Especially considering we do have a lot of discussions going on.
Can we drill into the weeds on some of this in our next budget committee meeting?
Yeah.
What does the administration want to do?
I think what they're they are asking for is anything available. They're hoping that, you know, with the promise that was made that we were going to be using ARPA funds for shelter operations in 2024, and the RFP was going out for that, I think that is what they're expecting. And shelter operations is in the tune of $750,000 a month, and that's $9 million a year. So that's what 2024 looks like. That doesn't include repairs and maintenance on the building. That doesn't include the lease payment, and that doesn't include ancillary costs for operations. That is just provided.
We've already paid for the bathrooms.
No,
that's no.
We have
part of it. Or
we have money set aside for the bathrooms. The contract has not come through. That's part of a larger conversation that you need to determine that if you want to have Trent be in perpetuity under the city, then yes, the bathrooms make sense. But again, you're not going to get the cost recovery for 18 months after the bathrooms are done.
We don't own that building.
We don't own that building, so it's not an improvement that you would see if you ever got out of the lease. You would never be reimbursed for it. And the cost recovery, the cost savings that you get on a per month basis would take 18 months to recover. And we haven't started that, and it'd be about 5-6 months to even get the project in completion.
Can we change our minds on that?
Yeah.
I mean, because I think all of us go between the human piece, and we have human beings living in this building that need bathrooms, but then this other side that we seem to be the only ones making the effort to.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
Council President, are we adjourned?
Thanks, Matt. Unless you have more questions.
Nope.
A little bit more lunch. Okay. Meeting is adjourned, and we'll see you on September 11th. September 11th. Thanks, everybody.
Happy Labor Day weekend.